But the fact is, everybody at the end of the day wants their brains to work better, and everybody has points in their life where they need to get more from the limited time that they have to learn or to train or whatever. And we're learning so fast, so much about how this works, that 5 years from now, we're going to know exactly the waveform to deliver that is best for whatever category of stuff you want to learn.
Bulletproof Radio, a state of high performance.
You're listening to Bulletproof Radio with Dave Asprey. Today's cool fact of the day is that clumps of cells in laboratory petri dishes just spontaneously formed brainwaves. These little lentil-sized clusters, by the way, these are lentils without lectins, apparently, of nerve cells. That was a super geeky diet joke. If you didn't get that, you'd have to read the Bulletproof Diet, sorry. Anyway, these nerve cells, about the size of dumb little beans, grow in a lab dish, and they start firing off rhythmic electrical signals. And those oscillations have some of the same features that we have in our own developing human brains as babies. These are little three-dimensional spheres of human brain cells. They're called cerebral organoids, and they're super simplistic models of the human brain. And in this study, researchers at UC San Diego coaxed stem cells into forming some of the neurons that make up the outer layer of the brain. And that's pretty fascinating neuroscience, but it makes you wonder, at what point does your brain become your brain? In this case, each of these organoids is about a million times smaller than a human brain. It lacks the complex combination of cells that help shape neural waves in people. They're not miniature brains, but just a model for a brain. But no one can tell you why they started doing that. So there's some questions at the very fundamental nature of consciousness, neuroscience, and human existence. Where do you draw the line? I don't really know, but I also know plants are smart too, and that's why I eat them. Today's episode is a special episode recorded live in San Francisco at the headquarters of Halo Neuro, because we're going to talk about electrical stimulation of the brain. I figured what better place to do that. And if you're interested in brains and performing well and things like that, you definitely want to check out Superhuman, my new book. It is just out there as we're recording the show. And you'll find really, really good value for you, especially if you realize that 1 in 10 people are likely to die of Alzheimer's. And what if there are ways to take care of your brain? What if there are ways to exercise your brain? Well, we're going to talk about some of the things you can do to make your brain stay young. And on my website, daveasprey.com, you can actually see a picture of my brain response time that says I'm responding with a 20-year-old's speed, even though I'm 46. Maybe some of the neurostimulation that we're going to talk about today is part of how I do that. Maybe it's just ping pong. Maybe it's mitochondrial enhancement. I don't really know, but you're going to learn a lot of cool stuff in today's episode. And it's really cool to be able to pick the brain of someone who's really looked at engineering and neuroscience, where they come together. So I'm going to be interviewing the co-creator of Halo Sport, which is the world's first convenient wearable neurostimulator for athletes specifically. You might have seen videos of me doing a ladder training, which I'm super not experienced in, with a Halo on my head. And I actually use this thing at home all the time. So with no further ado, I'm going to introduce you to Brett Wingeier, a PhD, CTO, co-founder of Halo, and a guy who's going to blow your mind.
Thanks, Dave. And thanks for coming to Halo. It's really awesome to have you here.
I was hoping you would completely freak out when I said you're going to blow my mind, because you're actually running electricity across it.
Yeah, that's what we're all about.
We didn't push any buttons for you?
No triggers here. No triggers. So Dave, what we're going to talk about today is we're going to talk about making brains better. And that's just about one of the most important things that we could possibly talk about.
So we're going to talk about coffee pretty much, because that's what it makes.
So I love coffee. Let's just get that out there.
Totally kidding.
I love coffee. So we could talk about coffee for an hour, and that'd be fantastic.
That would be my frontline technology for making the brain better. But the reason I wanted to pick your brain today was you know something about learning. And I know that people listening to Bulletproof Radio are interested in learning faster and just spending less time and energy getting stuff done. And since learning is a fact of life, we're all doing it all the time, what if you can acquire skills faster than normal? So
explain to me some of the history of what we know about how we learn and why you got interested in this in the first place.
Yeah. Well, so brains love to learn, and that's one of these fundamental things. It's neuroplasticity. That's what a brain does, is it optimizes itself to get the job done. And the way that's happening under the hood is your brain cells are firing. That's what they do. They fire together, and they're constantly forming stronger and weaker connections that help them work together in exactly the right networks for exactly the right output. And what do we mean by output? You know, that could mean the perfect backhand. It could mean the perfect ping pong overhand spin shot, or it could mean learning a language. It's all about your brain optimizing itself to get the job done.
I had a conversation with my son. He's 10, and he said, "Daddy, what is the fastest way to learn something, or what is the best teacher?" And I thought about it, and I said, "Gravity." And he said, "What?" And I said, "Because if you fall down, it hurts, and you won't do it again." So the point that I was teaching was, look, avoiding pain is something that we're wired into. Mm-hmm. So it seems like the first thing we learn is don't do things that hurt. And is that different than learn the perfect backhand, forehands, something else? What's going on there?
No, so it's exactly the same mechanism. Okay. And I hear you, because you know in raising kids, the guideline is, if you're looking at something they're doing, you want to evaluate that is going to be just painful enough to be a life lesson, but not bad enough to actually hurt you. So when your brain does something that has a good result, then it activates mechanisms that reinforce those connections. When your brain does something that leads to pain, then it activates mechanisms that make those networks less likely to fire together in the future. So it's the same effect. It's all neuroplasticity.
All right. I'm getting the neuroplasticity angle. It's a huge part of Headstrong. My book was about how do I increase my own neuroplasticity. And certainly one of the technologies is electrical stimulation. Mm-hmm. But it seems like the ability to acquire a new language, let's say, is such a far cry from learning how to walk or learning how to not fall on sharp things and things like that. At what point does learning stop being about pain avoidance and start becoming something that's more about skill acquisition? And what motivates those neurons to do that? How do we take control of that?
Well, so the cool thing here is that doing something well is so deeply satisfying, and that it's wired into us. You know that feeling you have when you execute on that perfect tennis stroke, and okay, that feeling you have if you're learning a language and you get out there and you say something right and you're out there, and it's this enormously pleasurable feeling. And so that sensation of learning and doing something well, that's the reward that causes that feedback that reinforces the connections that led to that great outcome.
I'm going to go back to pretty much my entire experience in school. And people appeared to want me to learn stuff that I just didn't really care about and it had no usefulness to me whatsoever. And by the way, if you're one of my teachers back then, I'm sorry, but I'm actually right. Most of what you were teaching me wasn't that useful, although I appreciate all of your service in putting up with my crap. But in all seriousness, I don't really care what year someone did something 500 years ago. All I care about is why they did it, right? But they never taught me the why. They just wanted me to memorize crap.
Right.
So how do you make yourself in your career as an adult or as a teenager, how do you make yourself learn stuff you don't want to learn?
Yeah, and it's hard, and it's focus. And one of the brain mechanisms that comes into this is what's called cognitive control. And that is something that we are absolutely better at right now than we were when we were kids. In a lot of ways our brains are it's getting harder to have them do what we want. Neuroplasticity goes down over time, reaction time, all these things. But one thing that we do tend to get better at is cognitive control, because our frontal lobes, they spent the first 25 years of our lives developing. And cognitive control is your brain's ability to focus on what you want it to focus on instead of necessarily what it wants to focus on or the view out the window or whatever.
So is this part of that with age comes wisdom?
With age comes wisdom. You know, if you And again, you know, there's plenty of stuff that does tend to go down as time goes by. But if you look at the plots, working memory decreases, reaction time decreases, ability to pack stuff into short-term memory decreases. The one thing that stays constant is knowledge of the world. And that's, you know, that's what we call wisdom, you know, and that's why, you know, you picture the old silverback gorilla who's still able to keep up and know some sneaky tricks to keep the dominance. That's the silverback gorilla. We're the silverback gorillas here, you know, having this world knowledge.
All right. So our brain performance goes down over time, at least if you don't do something about it. My experience, just from my own measurements, my hippocampal volume is 87th percentile. So it's not shrinking the way it's supposed to shrink. Mm-hmm. As I age, my reaction time on EEG to audio and video or visual stimuli is exactly that of a 20-year-old. Mm-hmm. I get more sleep in, well, last night, 5.5 hours than the average 20-year-old gets in 8 hours. Mm-hmm. And my working memory, I've trained that. Mm-hmm. So it's highly functional, probably better functioning than most 20-year-olds as well. Right. So all of these things are exercisable. There are things you can make the brain do if you have... Is it cognitive control you have to have in order to do that? Or is it willpower? And some of this training is annoying or it takes time. Mm-hmm. But what it enables people to decide that they're going to push themselves, whether it's physically or mentally, in order to do training on things like that.
Right, right. You know, so part of it is cognitive control, which I think is just kind of another name for willpower. And the ability to focus. You know, part of it is relevance. If it's always easier to learn something or train or practice anything if you feel like it's relevant to what you're doing every day, relevant to some goal that you actually care about.
All right, let's talk about relevance then. You have more than 50 patents in your name, and so you've been pretty successful in biomedical engineering, but you're also a singer-songwriter.
That's right.
Where's the relevance here? Like why do you do both of those things?
You know, I guess there's a couple answers to that. It's communication, and communication is fun. And one thing I realized about myself is to bring this back to learning. I'm what's called a performing introvert, meaning everything about, you know, how to kind of get out there and communicate. You know, there's people that comes naturally for, and, you know, again, I look at my 9-year-old, and that comes naturally to her. It comes naturally to my wife. For me, it was more of a learned skill. And part of that was just the enjoyment of the more you get out there, the more you use this, the more fun it is to communicate. And that's what music is for me. You know, I lived in New Orleans for a long time, and I did the singer-songwriter thing in the 90s and played at the bars and the coffee shops and everything, and wrote some songs. And, it's all communication. You know, it gave this, you know, this feeling of kind of, you know, putting it out there and connecting with people.
So it's the joy of skill acquisition is what drives you to do that.
Yeah. The joy of skill acquisition and then using that skill. Cause okay. You know, when you're writing a song, you're creating something, and there's a whole ton of neuroscience behind that as well.
Oh yeah.
You know, and the creative process is, part of it is where you're generating ideas and you want to take the filter off. And then part of it's where you're evaluating those ideas and you're discarding the 99% of those song lyrics that are just crap. And you put the filter on a little bit, and then you come out with that by pairing, taking the filter off and putting it back on, you end up with something creative. And then you put that together with the pleasure of learning the chord progression, learning everything, just being able to put it together, then execute on it. It's one of the most fun feelings that you could possibly have.
Do you find that there's a crossover between the physical movement things? And Halo is known for enhancing the motor cortex with electrical stimulation. So you get better physical skills. But we also know that the brain works better and improves anytime you have more muscles, anytime you move more, the brain increases function. Mm-hmm. Do you think that the neurostimulation, for what it does for your physical movement, has an effect on your personal singer-songwriter abilities? Is there a crossover?
Yeah, so yes. Yes is the short answer.
And just to be really clear, I'm asking about your experience, not a claim on your product, because you do work for Halo. So
yeah, okay. Yeah. Yeah. So you know, personally, there's a couple things there. So one is, as a musician, the more you dial in the technical aspects of what you're doing, if you're able to grab for that a fifth diminished chord exactly where you want it and your fingers just know what to do, then you can be free to be creative and express and improvise. And then if you turn to other brain targets, and again, this is from personal experience, the brain is more than just movement. And whether it's neurostimulation or all these other principles of learning, the same applies to learning the lyrics and learning how to perform and all these other things that your brain learns.
Do you use neurostimulation every day on yourself?
So I don't use it every day, mostly because I don't have time to train every day. And so I use it for climbing, and I use it for piano, and I use it a couple times a week for those. And for me, it's all about getting more out of less, because like you, like a lot of people, we don't have infinite time to train. The last time I had infinite time to train was when I was when I was six and time had no meaning, and I could go out and practice with the soccer ball or practice piano all day long. So it helps get more out of limited time.
When I talk about using neurostimulation, the way that I use this, and now we're talking specifically about the Halo sport, which is the thing that you helped to invent. This thing, you put it on and you do something for 20 minutes. And what I've done, my kind of ritual is, I will put it on and I'll hang out and make coffee with my son. Mm-hmm. And while my brain is doing that 20 minutes, it's sort of connect time. Mm-hmm. And then at the end of the 20 minute neuropriming period, there's an hour of enhanced neuroplasticity. Then I go down to the ping pong table and I kick his ass. And by the way, Alan, who probably is listening to this, yeah, I know you win it more than half the time, but I'm not going to admit that on the air, all right? But I found I could not keep up. The way 10-year-olds, we started playing when he was maybe six. Mm-hmm. I would play with my left hand. I'm not left-handed, just to make it kind of fair. And it's to the point where if I play all out, we're very evenly matched. Mm-hmm. The problem is he's 10. He's not done being neuroplastic. He keeps continuing. And I found that the only way that I could even be a challenging opponent was if I did neuropriming. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I'll actually do neuropriming and I'll start playing. And after that 20-minute period, I'll feel it kick in. It's like the ball slows down and now I can hit it. And it's a very tangible thing, mm-hmm. which is kind of cool, because years, in fact, you started Halo in 2013,
right?
Back in 2010, 2011, when the first TDCS research was coming out. TDCS, by the way, just stands for transdermal cranial stimulation, the ability to run an electrical current through a specific part of the brain. So I looked at this and I bought a device that was not meant for doing that. It was meant for driving drugs through the skin. Mm-hmm. And I said, all right, I'm going to do this. It was called the Chattanooga.
That's the one.
Quite expensive and really inconvenient to use. But I said, I'm going to do archery with this thing. The problem was, by the time I pasted these electrodes on there falling off my head, I never actually did it more than five or six times because it wasn't convenient and all. And I said, well, this is one of those things where it probably works for snipers and for drone pilots and that kind of skill acquisition, because they are using TDCS for those things. But then when you came out a couple of years later, I'm like, oh, this is kind of a cool piece of tech because it's just headphones that work. And I started using it. And the reason that I wanted to interview you is I've become quite a fan of this, because otherwise I can't keep up with my 10-year-old.
Right. Yeah. And, I've got a similar story with my 9-year-old, the learning for physical stuff is it's the same kind of learning that's going on with with cognitive language, anything. And I because it's all your brain optimizing itself. And I had this experience with my 9-year-old. She goes to the German school in San Francisco, and partially because we weren't fancy enough to get into the French school, and partially because she was just tuned to language from day one. And I watched her just come home, and it felt like in a couple months she was just fluent in German. And wow. And I said to my, we put her in the school, and I said to myself, we're going to learn German. It's going to be fantastic. We don't speak German. The last German speaker was my great grandfather, and we had every ambition of, all right, we're going to learn this right along next door. Nope. She talks smack about me in German. She comes home, she talks to her friends. They're probably talking smack to me even more in German. And you watch a kid learn, and it's this amazing thing. And it's because, number one, they have the time. Number two, they have the focus, and you know, depending on how you parent, they don't have as much of the, you know, you don't have the phone with the work emails popping up every 5 minutes if you're a kid, and you know, their neuroplasticity is just dialed in from day one because they've got this brain whose whole job, whose whole reason for existence is just soaking in information and learning skills.
That is, it's amazing to watch what they can do. But you talked about language, so I have an auditory processing unusual brain, and I've quantified this. There's narrow spectrums of sound that I don't hear the same in each ear, and it means that my auditory filtering is just different. And when I hear people speak French and Swedish, my wife is Swedish and speaks French, it sounds, I don't hear the sounds, it just sounds like mush. She can say a word to me and I'll say a different word back. It does not land in my brain. Mm-hmm. And that's always kind of pissed me off. So I did a couple different experiments. One is I used one of the very first infrared light stimulators for the brain specifically. It was this homemade little rickety thing. And I put it over my language processing center above the left ear. And I spoke in garbled words in English for the next several hours. It scared the crap out of me. Like, man, I make my business in tech communicating and all of a sudden I'm garbled. Fortunately, it got better. And I also tried running that ancient TDCS device before you came out with something usable over that same part of my brain. It didn't make me speak garbled, but I still couldn't do crap with French. Mm-hmm. So here's my question. When I'm stimulating my motor cortex, which is what the Halo Sport does today, is there anything I can do to make reading better, to make memory acquisition or your memory storage better, or to make my language, my hearing better, make my vocabulary better? Are there any benefits to just running a current there, or is this just for the motor cortex?
So same technology, different part of the brain.
So you move the electrodes around.
Exactly. Yeah. So there have always been if you look back at all the scientific background here, there have always been two main clusters of great results and data. And one of them is movement, primary motor cortex. And you know, that's the easiest to hit with something that looks like headphones. But the other cluster of data here is in prefrontal cortex.
That's where I always put it. So all right, I got to ask you this. Mm-hmm. I'm holding up this cool set of headphones with little rubbery combs on it that get through your hair. Couldn't I just take my Halo and wear it like a stupid headband instead of like a proper set of headphones and stimulate my prefrontal cortex? I know this probably isn't the look you were going for, but can I do this?
So it's
you're allowed to say no because you're not allowed to say yes.
No, so it's hitting the right part of your brain. You know that will hit prefrontal cortex. And you know, as a product designer, I'm going to step back and say, wait for Halo to. And I'm going to tease this a little here. I'm going to say wait for Halo to come out with something that is a prefrontal cortex stimulator and might be able to do exactly what you want and look good at the same time.
All right, it's very important that when I'm stimulating my brain that I look attractive. I slept with an EEG sleep monitor on my head for several years, the old Zio, and the very early days. Yeah, I've been tracking my sleep for more than 10 years, and a lot of the sleep hacking posts out there are copies of my original sleep hacking stuff. And I got to say, Victoria's Secret did not approve that model of headset, big blue, stupid neoprene thing,
right,
and all that. But I mean, it's nice. You actually have really good industrial design on Halo. Just I was CTO of one of the wristband companies that does monitoring called Basis. So that's all good. But I'm not sure most of us really even care. I mean, if you make me a little bit smarter and I have to look dumb for 20 minutes as I'm driving or something, I wouldn't care. But if you can make it cool, all right, how soon do I get that?
You know, we're working on it. Put it that way. And Dave, you might just get a sneak preview of that. And
that'd be terrible.
We might be looking at you to help beta test that.
I would love to be a beta tester. I envision a world, because I live in it, a world where it's not as hard as we think it is to do all sorts of stuff, and you can increase energy in the brain, and a lot of my work, how do I make the cells make more energy? But running a current through your brain also adds energy to your brain. Mm-hmm. And there's questions in neuroscience about how are electrons from an external source used? And we know from light that they actually can enter the electron transport chain. But do you think that we're going to end up in a future 5 years from now or something where we say, oh, great, you're 10 years old, put on this Halo hat, or you don't need it because you're 10, but you're 18 and you wanted to do this. So put this on and run this piece of software and it's going to be way easier than it was before.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. With a 10-year-old, they're so plastic and just so good at learning in the first place. You know, that's further off, but, somebody who's 18, somebody who has an adult brain, there's so much room to improve focus and attention and the ability to learn. You know, the potential of the brain is really limitless. You've got 100 billion neurons and 100 trillion synapses to optimize there. And one of the things about this field is we're learning so fast how all this works under the hood. And there's really some groundbreaking discoveries, even just this year, about how this interacts with the fundamental neuroscience and the fundamental mechanisms of how your brain processes information.
That seemed like a bit of a dodge. So I mean, we're 5 years now, you're saying we're not going to do it with kids. Mm-hmm. So we're learning some more. But are we really going to just say, okay, today I want to do X, so I'm going to stick this thing on my forehead or behind my ear or wherever else? Is this going to be a normal thing, or is this going to be the domain of pro athletes and Hollywood people want to memorize their lines better? Like, is this really a consumer tech?
So I'll give you the simple answer. Yes.
Okay.
So sure, 5 years out, it's probably going to still be somewhere on the adoption curve, but the fact is, everybody at the end of the day wants their brains to work better, and everybody has points in their life where they need to get more from the limited time that they have to learn or to train or whatever. And we're learning so fast, so much about how this works. That's why I mentioned that this when I answered before. If 5 years from now, we're going to know exactly the waveform to deliver that is best for whatever category of stuff you want to learn. And you're going to be able to dial that up. We're going to be able to pair it with training content, learning content, optimize the stimulation for your personal electrophysiology, optimize the stimulation for the ebb and flow of your training, dial it in and adapt it depending on how well you're doing. All that's going to be in the cards, and that's going to happen in the next decade. And I think we're going to be seeing that 5 years from now.
What do you say to the Waldorf parents? By the way, my kids are at a Waldorf school. So what do you say to the Waldorf parents who are saying technology, kids or even adults, this is unnatural. It's cheating. What's wrong with learning the old-fashioned way through repetition?
Yeah. So that's still a great way to learn. But the thing about this technology, and we call it neuropriming. The thing about this technology is you're still leveraging the brain's natural mechanisms of learning. And those are so powerful and so effective that it doesn't make sense to disrupt those. It's not the Matrix. We're not downloading Kung Fu into your brain. It's using technology to make sure that your brain is dialed in and ready to use its natural learning mechanisms where and when you want it. And that's, if you're, I'll use a athlete metaphor here. I was a rower in college, and I know when I got the most benefit out of my workouts, whether it was cognitive or physical, it was when I was just completely dialed in. I was engaged. I was ready to be neuroplastic and ready to focus. But I sure as hell was not dialed in every 5 a.m. practice. I was dialed in a fraction of those. So being able to bring that where and when you want it, that's huge. And so you're leveraging the natural learning mechanism of your brain.
Okay, so it's different than downloading Kung Fu, which is sad, because if you could do that, I'd totally sign up for that.
Likewise, give me 20 years for that one.
All right, 20 years for that one. There's something about, in my perspective on all this, about respecting your time here on Earth. Mm-hmm. Like, look, you could learn it twice as fast in exactly the same way. The end results are the same. Mm-hmm. Then why wouldn't you do it faster? And that's why I do my meditation with a computer telling me how to do it better and deeper and faster. So I can say, hurry, meditate.
Right.
With legitimacy. And I think what you're saying is, if you're going to bother exercising, you might as well make your brain more neuroplastic so the exercise will stick better and you'll improve faster.
Right.
Now, what do you say to the people who say, well, what is the Halo now? What does it cost?
Costs $399.
Okay. And by the way, that price isn't real for Bulletproof Radio listeners because, and thank you for doing this, you're offering $100 off for everyone who listens to the show and uses code DAVE at checkout. So that's a massive savings. So now it's $300 or slightly under. So people are going to say, well, how is it that, you know, some athletes have a $400 device and other athletes don't have access to this technology? Aren't we creating a divide where, you know, only the people who can afford to learn can learn quickly?
Well, you know, you're thinking about access like that. Sure, it's always part of the conversation with a new technology. But if you go into any gym where people are seriously training and you look around, if there's a rack of Halo Sport in that gym, those Halo Sports might be the single cheapest thing in the gym. You know, there's there's technology in these gyms and performance labs that costs hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Yeah, I have that upgrade labs thing down in LA. It's a lot of money for that kind of gear. So you're saying, look, if you go to a gym, you're spending $100 a month, mm-hmm. right? And there are people who can't afford to go to a gym and they go to the park and or they don't have time to exercise or whatever.
Right.
But that there's always advantages and disadvantages. It's a spectrum. And $400 is within the realm of consumer possibility, especially if it doubles your workout effectiveness.
Right.
So then the ROI is very high on it. I do find I'm about 2 to 3 times a week is just because of the amount of time that I travel and the amount of time that I'm home and there's ping pong available and all that. what is the optimal amount of brain stimulation like that you would say for the average human?
So this is one of those things where we turn to the science and with brain stimulation, with anything with the brain, anything with your brain or body. You know, you don't want to train by running a marathon every day. And at some point, there's a point of diminishing returns.
Mm-hmm.
So if you look at the science, what the science squarely backs up is using this once a day on the order of, say every day, 5 days a week, 2 or 3 days a week is perfectly fine. We don't really know where the point of diminishing returns is. Some of the science suggests if you do longer than a 30-minute session, which we don't recommend, we don't let you do, then there's probably some diminishing returns.
Is there harm?
So there's no evidence of harm. There's any kind of training, if you use it past that point of diminishing returns, it might not be a good use of your time. It might be counterproductive. There's no harm.
There's no harm. Okay. So that's a good thing. Having a good safety bar makes it a good decision to do something. I, for 20 years, have done electrical brain stimulation. Before TDCS was created, the Russians pioneered alternating current across the brain part of the space program.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, well, it's real expensive to send an astronaut to space and then they sleep a third of the time. Why don't we just get rid of as much sleep as we can so we can use less rocket fuel? Mm-hmm. That's a very Russian and very cool way of thinking about solving a problem. And so they have this alternating current thing and you could do that to sleep better. So I said, all right, I've been working on hacking my sleep and I used to suck at sleep. So there were times when I would sleep for only 3 hours a night, but I'd run 1.5 hertz current back and forth between my ears and I'd wake up feeling amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, what just happened? This is totally not what I would have expected. And for hangover cures, I've definitely seen results from both TDCS and alternating current. And I may or may not have given my Halo to a friend who was hungover and seen that they felt way better after 20 minutes.
I will file that away and we're going to have to work on some waveforms for that.
I imagine there probably are some that would be more effective than that, but it was actually really profound.
Mm-hmm.
The one case, the person was wrecked. And I said, well, why don't you try some brain stimulation? And literally in 10 minutes, it was like, oh, I'm fine now. I'm good to go. And it was someone flicked the light switch back mm-hmm. on. Neurologically, biochemically, bioengineering wise, what's going on with the electricity in the brain and effects like that?
Yeah. So, so you mentioned AC. So, and this is one of the most exciting things in the whole field right now because.
Just to be clear, we use direct current. We use the Halo Sport in the case I'm talking about there. I've used my old alternating current stuff from the 90s as well.
Yeah. So the mechanism for any of this, when you deliver an electric current to the scalp, enough of that makes its way through the scalp, through the skull. Those electrons in the form of ions, once they get into your scalp and into your body, they create an electrical field around your neurons. And what that electrical field does, whether it's AC or DC, all of those neurons are participating in the same electrical field because it spreads out over that patch of brain. So what you're doing there is when you've got a moderate electrical field over all these neurons, it makes them more likely to fire together because they're all participating in the same electrical field. Now, if it's AC or DC, it does that a little bit differently, but at the end of the day, you're helping neurons fire together, and that's the whole mechanism of how your brain optimizes itself and how synapses change and rearrange themselves.
Well, that'll drive synaptogenesis, growing new synapses and things like that. The other part of learning, though, especially skill acquisition at expert levels, is myelinogenesis, growing myelin, the electrical insulation around nerves like that. Mm-hmm. And some forms of electrical stimulation will increase myelin. Essentially, the more electrical current the nerve has to carry, the more the body says, maybe I should insulate that one. And when it's insulated, you're right. More of an expert. What I don't know, what I'm asking you now is the amount of current that comes from Halo enough to drive myelin formation, or is this just about synapse formation?
So the amount of current that's coming from Halo or any kind of technology like this is it's probably not enough to directly drive myelin formation. Although I gotta say I'm not an expert in that in that part of this. But what it does drive is it drives this synchronous neural firing, which synaptogenesis is only part of it, because part of the changes that happen, you have this structural change of generating new synapses, but the way all of the fine-tuning happens is the strength of all of these 100 trillion synapses is constantly being adjusted so that when you get a signal from one neuron, the next one along is either more or less likely to fire. And that happens way faster than synaptogenesis. And that's actually the core mechanism of how your brain optimizes itself. Now, once you have enough of that happening, you can get synaptogenesis, you can get different patterns of firing, and then that can drive the myelin, the myelination that you're talking about.
Okay. That makes a lot of sense. Yeah, the more they're firing, the more you're going to get it. The things that I'm familiar with that drive myelin specifically are more peripheral nerves. Right. So some of the electrical stimulation gear that I have that it feels like your body's kind of being hit with a taser. Right. That stuff will definitely drive myelin. It's kind of ridiculous what some of it does, but it's intense.
Right.
I don't think I'd want to put that on my brain.
Right. Although the Russians probably have, like 50 years ago.
I'm certain they have. if it wasn't the Russians, it was the East Germans.
Right.
That's where, in fact, a surprising number of pieces of research about electricity in the brain have come from Russia and East Germany. Mm-hmm. Do you know why?
You know, every culture has a different approach to science. And I think there's something that resonates with the Soviet scientific mind.
Yeah.
It's like, let's put electrodes on it. Let's see what happens.
I very much appreciate that mindset. I think it's cool. And you look back in the field, that Russian stuff was late 60s, mm-hmm. but there weren't a lot of papers, at least not a lot of English papers. But in the last 15 years, how much research is there around not just reading electricity from the brain, because there's lots of that, but actually putting electricity into the brain? Is it dozens of papers, or is it a little bit more?
I mean, it's thousands. There's 4,000 plus papers at this point. And,
okay.
You know, and the whole modern field got kind of re-kicked off in 1999 by a German team, actually, at the University of Göttingen. And they basically said, hey, look at motor cortex. We can create these really, really reliable, robust effects and see it happen time after time again in this person and that person and the next person. Okay, so what do we do with this? It's clearly neuroplasticity. So then scientists all over the world started picking this up, showing that you can use it to accelerate benefits from training or learning. And, you know, now we're standing at a point where not just DC, but AC and something called TRNS, which uses a broad spectrum random noise. It's been out there in the world of science for, kind of a long time in technological terms.
It's funny, at 40 years of Zen, which is the neuroscience company that I started, that 5 days intensive work with custom neuroscientists working on your brain, we use AC on the brain as a small part. It's mostly neurofeedback based, but to get the brain ready, we'll use AC on the brain, just alternating current back and forth instead of just through one part of the brain. And we'll use the random noise. And the effects are really profound. The problem is it takes a huge amount of clinical gear, and it's something we do in order before we do certain kinds of neurofeedback or other personal development oriented training. So I've seen the effects. I actually have the clinical grade gear at home to do that stuff, but you can't really buy that unless you have some sort of license. This is not the sort of stuff. But I'm really interested in the effects. So is this something that might be coming from you guys?
Especially as we turn to cognitive applications. I'm going to say yes. A lot of the best, most recent data in using frontal stimulation, using this for learning and memory and things like that. It's using alternating currents.
Well, there was a study, the New York Times reported on it, which is really cool. Like, what are the odds of brain electrical stimulation, neurostimulation ever being the New York Times? You go back 10 years, this was the era of science fiction and just craziness. And now it's not just real, it's being recognized as real.
Right.
And the study that I'm thinking of showed that this alternating current across the brain improved working memory in older adults, so they perform the same as young adults.
Exactly. So this was a group at Boston University, and the Rob Reinhart and Jonathan Nguyen, if I remember his name correctly. And so it was a beautiful study because it was one of these studies where they did the thing. First of all, they did the thing that everybody tries to do when they do the science, which is they show, okay, this works. Alternating current stimulation made working memory better. But then they did a few other things. They looked at the EEG and what's called phase amplitude coupling. They showed that when you see this working, you also see an increase in phase amplitude coupling. They compared it with younger participants and showed that, okay, this doesn't work as well in younger individuals because there's not as much headroom to get better. Then they stimulated opposite to the way they showed work, and they showed, okay, look, we can make people a little worse by stimulating the other way, which, it's not super useful out there in the world, but it's a huge part of the science.
Oh, it's really useful to be able to make people worse. One of the things that drove me down the neuroscience interest path that I have is I got my first EEG machine in 1997 and started doing things to my own brain. The problem is, though, doing brain surgery on yourself is usually a bad idea.
That's a good rule to live by. Right?
And so you realize your perception of reality can be changed. And I mean, I had one time just not that long ago where I didn't take the time to properly seat two of the electrodes. And I was doing some really advanced, off the record brain training sort of things. Mm-hmm. And I do train protocols that are there for, advanced states of consciousness and human performance that aren't on the menu.
I would expect no less.
But man, I had two electrodes loose, so I wasn't getting a signal from them. I was a zombie. I mean, for 3 days, I couldn't, I was just dysfunctional. And that's why I have a couple of neuroscientists working for me as well. So I'm like, let's troubleshoot this. And we looked at the record of the training and realized electrodes are loose. So we actually up-trained those parts of the brain. But the moral of the story is that if you can use the technology to make someone worse, it means it takes someone like you with, 50 patents and you've studied neuroscience for a long time to figure out how to do this. Not just in a study somewhere, but to do this on a large number of people's brains and to do it in a way that's going to be beneficial by making phase coupling happen. So I would like to have that so I can wake up in the morning instead of strapping on a bunch of gear from a neuroscience lab with Velcro and goop and all that crap to be able to just put on a Halo headset and say, make my brain act like a young brain today.
Yeah.
How long is it going to be till I can do that?
So we're on it.
All right, you're working on it.
We're on it. Yeah, that's and
you don't have to give me a launch date, but we're talking in the order of a year or two, not 5 years.
Yeah, I think we're talking a year or two here.
Okay,
and that's exciting on its own. And just talking about kind of what the future holds here, what we and everybody in the field, I think, will have in 5 years is the ability to not just deliver this neurostimulation, but to personalize it. Because one of the key principles of interacting with the brain is you've got to close the loop. And that's actually what my co-founder and I did at our previous company, NeuroPace, was we we were working on implantable neurostimulators for epilepsy.
Yep.
Well, you know, that neurostimulation works pretty well if you turn it on and leave it on. It turns out it works better if you watch for seizures about to start, and then you stimulate right when the seizure is about to start. So, you know, it turns out it's this general principle for working with the brain. Everything is better when you personalize it, when you close the loop and you make it responsive. So we have our electrical engineers right now working on things like being able to record biosignals mm-hmm. from the headset. You know, that's not wow. today, it's not tomorrow, it's not 2 years from now, but that's kind of the wave of the future. And that's the kind of thing that you know, not just us, but everybody out in the field and in academia is thinking about.
There's been a long-standing problem of getting electrical signals off the brain mm-hmm. Because when you move, your muscles make electricity that's way stronger than your brain electricity, so you get artifacts all over the place.
Right.
So if you solve that problem with a pair of headphones, kudos. That's been just a long-standing neuroscience annoyance.
Yeah, it's a hard problem, and one of my biggest moments of chagrin in my scientific career was back. So my PhD was in EEG and electric fields in the brain, and back in 1998, I spent about a week thinking I'd made an earth-shattering discovery of, you know, there's this synchrony, and it happens in the temporal lobes, and it happens when you know, we were watching people doing mental subtraction, and this was when everybody in the field was starting to appreciate a lot of what synchrony between different parts of the brain. And I thought this was like Nobel Prize material. And then we realized this was a participant who was, they had math anxiety, and they were clenching their teeth when they were doing this mental calculation. And it wasn't even brain. It was their temporal muscles, with all this highly coherent activity because they were clenching their jaw.
Artifacts are just the bane of anyone's existence who works on this. People listening to the show be like, what the heck is an artifact? But here's the thing. If we're working on a signal, you're working on increasing motor function with running a current, and you think you're getting increased motor function, but you're not because of bad data, for example, it's a massive problem in science. And even things like fMRI, which is a way we've been looking at people's brains, they just noticed that the algorithms used for pretty much all fMRI research for the past 15 years were wrong.
Right.
So all
right.
these neuroscience conclusions were wrong. So the ability to actually get a real picture of what's going on in the brain so you can perform it is really hard work. But you've done way more work on it than I have. How hopeful are you that we're going to actually get good signals of what's going on in the brain when we're just going about our daily business?
You know, it's hard, but it's doable.
Okay.
You know, there's everybody in the field has learned a lot more about what does artifact look like? How do you separate it out? And you know, so much of this is understanding. You can't always get good signals, but what you got to be able to do is understand when are we getting a good signal and when aren't we? Because it's okay if they're not great signals all the time. You've just got to be able to understand when is it good so you can draw your conclusions from that.
Okay, so the ability to parse out the bad stuff. I've worked with the developer at 40 Years of Zen to say, mm-hmm. all right, how do we identify a bad signal just to just cut that out? Like, I just don't want that. And I think there's lots of neuroscientists all over the place looking at machine learning and different ways to get that out. You guys clearly have the ability to know what's going on in the brain because you're an expert, and because we just walked through the labs, I've seen all your gear there. So you have the ability to say, all right, we're going to stimulate the brain and see what the brain does, which is super cool. I want the day when I can get on my iPad, I can say, oh, here's what my kid's brain's doing. Here's what my brain's doing.
Right.
Yeah, here's what all of our employees' brains are doing. And wow, they're all in chaos. Like maybe we could do something about that. Not in an invasive way, mm-hmm. but in a helpful way. I don't want to read people's minds, although that'd be fun too. But what I'd like to be able to do is be like, this person's like seriously not in a good place. Maybe we can just say, why don't you take the day off? Like wouldn't that mm-hmm. be awesome?
Yeah,
but right now
we
don't have the signal.
Right.
Right. And if we did have the signal, there's probably some, you know, so a whole bunch of privacy and ethical questions and things like that. But the bottom line is if you own your signal and you can say, all right, I'm getting a red alert on my phone that says mm-hmm. my brain is jacked today, maybe I'm going to do something. Right?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. We're painting a picture of the future that could either be really dark or really, really beneficial. But along the way, the ability to learn in less time is, I don't think there's any ethical questions about that that are credible. People say, well, it's not fair, it's cheating, whatever. Using clothes to stay warm is also cheating. So we're going to just let the Luddites die. That's what happens to them. I want to talk about some of the cool new stuff that you're working on with Halo.
Yeah.
I talked about language acquisition, which is actually really a hard thing to do. Mm-hmm. But we also mentioned music. And right. You're doing something now specifically to study neuroscience and music. What are you doing with Halo around that?
Right. So we have this partnership with Berklee College of Music, and it's the Berklee in Boston, not the Berklee just across the bay. Obviously the legendary music school, and we actually kicked that off this summer. And the way we started was we offered a fellowship for music students, a couple from Berklee, Stanford, to come here and do some experiential work and some controlled studies using neurostimulation for music performance, for songwriting, actually.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, we had a songwriter, and she used not Halo Sports, she used a different form factor to increase creativity. And she more than tripled her output of songs because she was able to dial up and dial down that creative output and the ability to focus.
Through electrical stimulation, not feedback?
Through electrical stimulation.
That's fascinating. I want to learn more about that. I'm intrigued that there might be specific stimulation things that anyone listening to the show could do that would allow them to be better creators. When is this going to be commercially available?
Right. Yeah. So
I'm not pushing on you or anything here.
No pressure.
Like, sign
no pressure.
Me up.
Yes. You know, the answer there is, again, this is prefrontal cortex. So it's, okay. You know, it's not today and it's not tomorrow, but it's on a roadmap and it's something to be looking for in the next, in the next year or two. And again, Dave, you're probably going to see it.
You're going to hook me up. All right. That's good. Cause do you remember there was like something, I'm probably going back to the 90s. And if you were like in a certain gang, you'd put your bandana really low over your forehead.
Oh yeah. Yep.
Right. So I'm not opposed to taking my current Halo and just kind of giving myself that kind of monobrow with it. Cause if it's going to double or triple my writing output or make me a better podcast interviewer or whatever, I would do that right before an episode in a minute. Okay, so that's pretty exciting. And you have a long history of working with pro athletes. You're doing some stuff with Titleist Performance Institute, which is a very well-respected thing in golf. What's going on there?
Yeah. So you know, one of the things about TPI is you know, they're all about using practice time wisely and really, you know, really scientifically refining every part of the golfer's stroke. Charlie Hoffman, you know, just really successful golfer lately. He's a pretty dedicated Halo user, and you know, it works for him the same way it works for you and me, which is helps him get more out of the amount of time he has to train, because you know, nobody wants to be in there on the driving range 8 hours a day.
Well, plus, your shoulder wears out.
You know? Exactly. Yeah, and that, you know, that's one of the key things. You know, we've learned from working with not just professional athletes, but with people like U.S. Special Forces. You know, when we first started working with Special Forces, and we started talking to these guys, and you know, we started the conversation in terms of, okay, you can get better, and they were like, we don't want to get better. We're already at the top of our game. What we want is to be able to maintain this strength and skill with less time in the gym, so that our guys have less chance of getting injured and can spend more time working on other stuff like, you know, these professional skills, learning languages, you know, strategy, all the other things that make up their skill set.
It sounds like the same thing everyone listening wants. Hold on, did I want to spend more time doing what I wanted and less time doing stuff to maintain myself?
Right.
I'm all over that. Everything that we do as human beings since the beginning of time has been about saving time and energy, right, so you can do what you want.
Right.
So this is just a continuation of that, even at the highest special forces level.
Yeah.
Okay. Something we haven't talked about yet, something that really intrigues me. You mentioned when I was coming into the office in the elevator, I didn't realize you'd written some papers on it until I looked through my notes. It's around endurance, which is very different than skill acquisition.
Right.
And you're finding that people actually have muscle, that their muscle fatigue doesn't happen as quickly if their brain is stimulated or they're able to cycle for longer. Tell me about what you figured out there, because this is groundbreaking. We have a lot of even pro athletes who listen to the show, not to mention the weekend warrior types. So what does brain stimulation do for endurance?
Yeah. So there's two parts to that answer. And the short answer is it helps your endurance. It increases your time to exhaustion. And it also, there's this feedback between skill and endurance where that gets compounded if you bake in your skills into muscle memory more, because then you can keep your form for longer.
So it takes less electrons to manage them.
Yeah, and you know, let me give you an example from my athletic career. I was a rower in college, which was fantastic and sometimes brutal and cold and wet, but you know, an amazing experience. But one of the things about any kind of endurance sport is you get out there and you're really pushing the limits of your capability. And as you do that, you get more and more pain, more and more fatigue, and your technique starts to break down. And once that happens, the pain starts compounding. And all of that you get this cascade of failure when you're at the limits of your endurance. And one of the antidotes to that is to bake everything better and better into your muscle memory so you can keep good technique in the face of that pain and fatigue. That's part of the answer. That's a super powerful effect, and that's something that I've seen myself in my own training. The other part of the answer is that endurance is all about your motor cortex's ability to keep firing all of those neurons, to keep those systems running, create synchronous output to your muscles, again, in the face of pain and fatigue. And that's something that you can train your motor cortex to do. And by using neurostimulation, you can actually increase your motor cortex's ability to keep all that going in the face of exhaustion.
How much longer?
So the best data show it's incremental but meaningful improvements, things like 10, 20, 30%.
So you could potentially cycle 20% longer than you normally could?
Right.
This is if you primed your brain before you cycled, or are you priming it while you're cycling? Do you have to wear the halo under your helmet? How does that work?
Yeah, so this would be a 20-minute session.
Okay.
Before your training.
Wow. Okay, so these are very meaningful numbers. What about muscle strength, you know, weightlifting kind of stuff?
So same thing for muscle strength. One thing that's a really cool fact about strength is that when you first go into the gym, like let's say you haven't been training and you go into the gym and you start a strength training program, you get these immediate gains in strength. And it's not your muscles getting bigger, it's not your physiology changing yet. It's that your brain is actually getting better at sending those signals to your muscles, so you get all the right contractions at all the right times for a smooth, powerful output. So
wow. In the studies you did you use the Halo Sport 1, the first one that I used, or the brand new, the Halo Sport 2, which is the one I've been using for about the last 6 months?
So most of the studies were Halo Sport 1.
Okay, got it. But it's the same waveform and 2, just 2 is a better form factor?
Same waveform, same nibs, all
the way. All right. Yeah. The Halo Sport 2 is more affordable and cooler.
Exactly.
And you've got, what, 2 studies out on this?
Right.
Okay, so would it be out of line to say if people are listening to the show and they wanted to be able to lift at least 10% longer, or we're talking increases in strength or increases in or decreases in the amount of time it takes to get fatigued?
Yeah, so both. Okay. So
they can lift more.
Right.
Okay, and they can go for longer.
Exactly.
All right. So at least a 10% improvement is what you found in the study.
That's so a 10% improvement for at least a 10% improvement for something like time to exhaustion.
Okay.
The data in strength, it depends on what kind of athlete you are.
Okay.
If you're a beginner, then you're going to get better faster. And those gains are probably going to be on the order of, you know, 10, 20, 30% faster. If you're an experienced athlete, you know, you're not going to get 10, 20, 30% stronger. Some cases that would make you superhuman.
Yeah.
We did a study with Sparta Science, which is this performance center down in Menlo Park. Mm-hmm. And you know, those guys got 3, 4, 5% stronger, more explosive on things like vertical leap. That's, you know, if you're a skilled athlete, that's super meaningful.
That is a massive improvement. All right, well, those studies I think just speak for themselves in terms of what Halo Sport does for people who really want to move well. I've just found that even the fine muscle stuff, the ability to hit a spin shot, seeing the ping pong ball slow down, this is meaningful stuff. And I think it isn't yet a a big enough part of the national conversation about, hey, if you wanted to improve, you could do this. And there's nothing that says you can't have one Halo in your family.
Right.
You know, you share it with people. I haven't let my kids use it though, because I figure I don't really know. And I'm sure that the insurance companies say you have to be 18 or older for this.
Not only are kids super neuroplastic and just super good at learning and training anyway.
Mm-hmm.
If your kid, your skull is thinner, your brain doesn't instantly change when you turn from 17 to 18, but it is intended for adults only.
Yeah, it's also not sized for kids.
Right.
So I've never run electrical stimulation on the kids. I definitely do feedback training so their brain can better regulate itself. But it feels like this is an adult technology.
It is.
And this is kind of a leading question I set you up there, because your prefrontal cortex doesn't really get baked until you're 24 or 25.
Right.
Is this something for young adults as well?
So yes. And one of the reasons I say that is because basically all of the neuroscience literature that's ever been produced, studied, every study that's been done virtually happens to have been done in neuroscience undergrads and grad students. So
okay, that's really smart. Like, pretty much they've only tested people in their early 20s.
Right, right.
There's
a lot of studies where, you know, they've intentionally gone out and done adults, but if there's a result you see in the neuroscience literature, It has probably been shown in people from 18 to about 24.
Okay, that is profound. I'm just thinking, I've done neurofeedback on my parents in their 70s. I haven't gone into like their 90s. I've had people come through after their 70s in the training, but I'm just wondering, like, should I go to my grandmother, give her my full stack of cognitive enhancers, and then put a Halo Sport on her to see what she does?
So
she's 97.
97. Well, so. I can't speak for the nootropics and the some of the cognitive enhancers, but I can speak to neurostimulation.
Okay, let's talk about that. I just feel like it works better if the cells have enough power to like fire up again.
Yeah, yeah, and you know there are changes that happen late in life, and I think if you step back and look at the data, we scientists will look at the data. The data get more clear in healthy older adults. Because there, you know, because there's and healthy older adults up to a certain point, you know, and the data, you know, 75, maybe 80, looking at results like this, you know, like this Reinhardt study we talked about, because at that point there's more headroom to improve. You're part of the way into this path of decline in working memory and things like that, and there's more need for something to help with it. Now, if you get to somebody who's 95, there are changes in. You know, there's changes in brain anatomy. There's a thicker layer of cerebrospinal fluid, and it puts you in a place where the data aren't as well baked.
But also, there are vanishingly few healthy older adults.
Right.
So the sample size gets smaller and smaller. As a guy with a track record of being right before the study is a good amount of the time, i.e. keto and stuff, I would bet on the electrical stimulation as being a beneficial thing to do a couple times a week. In general, as part of a broad spectrum anti-aging brain program.
Well, and
I've been doing it for 20 years.
So. Yeah. Yeah. And you know, one of the things about this technology is it's best used when you pair it with some kind of cognitive training learning. So, you know, we're not saying don't do the crosswords, don't do the brain training. Take neurostimulation, pair it with high quality, mindful, thoughtful brain training, physical training, and then it's all gonna operate synergistically.
That sounds like a pretty good program for performing well for decades and decades and decades. Well, that was my final question for you, other than the final,
bring it.
How long are you going to live? I mentioned my number of 180. You've got 50 patents. You're a bioengineering neuroscientist guy. You know a thing or two. What's your number?
How long am I going to live? I think at least 150 is.
There we go. High five on that one.
You know, there's so much. We're learning so much.
Yeah.
And you know, it's the stuff you're working on. It's the stuff that's out there in labs all over the world. And the stuff that's gonna cure cancer, and is gonna fundamentally figure out how to how to reverse these cellular processes of aging, where you have the ends of your telomeres or whatever, you're getting knocked off bit by bit. The work that is going to nail that, it's probably happening literally right now.
We're hacking all of it. And in fact, that's one of the seven pillars of aging that I write about in Superhuman, where there are teams making massive progress on all these things and the progress is accelerating. And heck, let's neurostimulate all the teams doing that and make it accelerate even more. But it's all feeding back on itself. So I just don't think you're crazy at 150. It just sounds achievable. So good for you, man.
Awesome. Well, I'm looking forward to meeting up 100 years from now and comparing notes.
Well, if you liked today's episode, there's probably a couple things that you want to do. One is you might want to start incorporating neurostimulation into your life, because whether you're going to go to yoga class or do whatever your sport is, or maybe you don't really have a sport because you just exercise a little bit to stay healthy, you're still going to get more per minute out of your exercise if you do it neurostimulated than not. So if you want to do that, go to haloneuro.com, haloneuro.com, use code DAVE and save $100, which is a meaningful amount of money. And while you're at it, you should be reading Superhuman, because if you're not reading Superhuman, you're probably not a superhuman. So you can pick that up anywhere books are sold. And if you were to actually use the Halo sport while you are reading Superhuman, no one knows what will happen, but maybe you can be the first.